Good afternoon. I am Alice Soni, the Deputy Dean of College of Nursing. We are very happy to start our next series, this webinar. Last time we had a webinar on cardiac series. Now we are moving on to neurology sciences. And today's webinar is going to be conducted by Mrs. Rebecca Sumathi Bai. She is a professor of neurology nursing and also currently the president of Society of Neurosciences Nurses in our country, and she has very vast experience, around 29 years of experience working in neurology department, and she's a very apt person. And right now she's very busy with the patients with COVID suspects and positive patients, and also dealing with neurological sciences. And this series, I know you must be wondering why the series on cerebral vascular accident is going to be held today. And we know that you have been exposed to a lot of webinar series these days, and especially in relation to COVID. So as planned, we thought we'd continue with this series along with the other webinars you're already exposed to. So without much delay, I hand over the session to Mrs. Rebecca Sumathi Bai.
Hello, good evening, and a warm welcome to the webinar series on the neurological diseases. I'm very happy to do this because we can share a lot of thoughts with many of you, and we can have a good dialoguing through this and at the end of it. I have with me in the department Ms. Marcy, who is a professor, and Ms. Deborah, who is a reader, and all two of them will join with me in doing this neurological series. And the next three sessions are going to be on cerebrovascular accident, which is in short called as stroke. And this first 1 hour, I will be only dealing with the introductory aspects and maybe a little more of classification and risk factors. And the most important of the medical management and the nursing assessment will be done by the other speakers the next week and the following. So this is so I welcome all of you. Please share, keep your questions. We are happy to answer how much is possible. And this time we are actually running around for the COVID-19 infection, and we are fully occupied with that kind of work. But still, in spite of that, we also have patients coming with stroke. So I'm still happy to talk about stroke because that is my own interest also. So as an overview, these are the topics: introduction, risk factors, classification, clinical manifestations, pathophysiology, diagnostic tests, medical management, nursing assessment, management, rehabilitation, and conclusion. And so as I said in the beginning, I will start with it, and then Ms. Mercy will take you through the medical management, then Ms. Deborah will take you through the nursing assessment, and I will conclude with rehabilitation. As an introduction, all of us know stroke occurs if the flow of oxygen-rich blood to a portion of the brain is blocked, which we generally call it as ischemic stroke. And sudden bleeding in the brain, which also is a stroke and is commonly called as hemorrhagic stroke. These are the main broad classifications. We always deal with ischemic stroke or an hemorrhagic stroke. And stroke is a serious medical condition. Why do we call it a serious medical condition? Because the time that we spend on delaying without treatment is going to be very detrimental for the brain cells. And so the earlier that we identify the stroke symptoms, the earlier that we intervene with the condition will really help the patient in preventing disability and also mortality. TIAs often are caused by blood clots. They are not full-blown strokes, but then you cannot just ignore it away because these are the warning signs of stroke. And if you see two pictures here, a familiar picture for all of you if you in the net. The first one, the first image is the hemorrhagic stroke where you have a blood vessel which can leak and you can start the blood vessels burst and then there's blood leaking into the brain tissue. It can be a minimal leak or it can be a very massive leak. Both are dangerous. The second picture is a picture of ischemic stroke where the clot or a thrombus that is occupied or in the blood vessel stops the blood supply to a particular area of the brain and causes a whole lot of necrosis there. In that particular area, you have two kinds of tissues which is called as core infarct area and a penumbra area, which we will discuss more when we talk about the pathophysiology. Now this picture is a picture of a sand clock, or we call it as an hourglass, which just tells you that time is, you know, slowly the time passes away. I want to put this picture and correlate it with the stroke because time is brain. Every second when we delay without treating a patient with stroke, there are about 32,000 cells die, and in a minute about 1.9 million cells die, and that's a huge loss for the brain, and that can really put the patient disabled, if not mortality, at least disabled, because we all know that brain cells cannot regenerate. Of course, there are now many theories which suggest about the collaterals that arise. The dendrites becomes a collateral. Already some primary collaterals are there in the brain, but the collaterals will be created and that will take care of the area where there is an ischemic effect. And so the set of arteries that you have in circle of Willis, as you see here, is the one that is the V-shaped is called as the vertebral artery, which becomes basilar artery when it enters the foramen magnum. Then you have the posterior cerebral artery, with the posterior communicating artery, and which connects to the middle cerebral artery, and that connects to the anterior cerebral artery with an anterior communicating artery. So this is circle of Willis, which is a joint. So circle of Willis is very, very important when we talk about a stroke. So the anterior circulation, MCA, that is middle cerebral artery, ACA, which is anterior cerebral artery, and anterior choroidal artery is called as anterior circulation. And vertebral artery, basilar artery, and posterior cerebral artery, PCA, is called as posterior circulation. Now, if I have to tell you what is this anterior circulation supplies the front portion of the brain. We can say the frontal lobes, including the eyes, the ophthalmic, and all that. The posterior circulation mainly supplies the cerebellum, the brainstem, and the spinal cord. So that's the brief anatomy. And if I have to tell you, the blood supply of the artery of the brain is about 750 ml per minute. Brain does not have a store of its own, and so blood has to be supplied to provide oxygen and glucose to, otherwise the brain cells will die. So it's about 15% of the cardiac output is being supplied to the brain. And the cerebral arteries are very, very peculiar. They are not like the other systemic arteries because there are only two layers in the cerebral arteries. And they can become weak when there is, the layers can become very weak and then they given to burst or to become an ischemic area if they are not taken care of well. So going on to the risk factors, you can see here the two types of risk factors. One is called as non-modifiable risk factors, the other one is non-modifiable. I will just brief in with you the non-modifiable. and then we will talk a little more about the modifiable. Non-modifiable risk factors are the five: age, gender, race, ethnicity and family history. They call non-modifiable because you can't do much about this. But what you have to remember is about the age. When we relate age with stroke, after 55 years, every decade there is a double risk of developing a stroke. If you see in India, these patients who are above 55 years, the stroke increases and we have more patients. Coming on to the gender, generally men have a greater incidence of stroke, but when it comes to the recovery, men recover faster than women. And also they say there is the kind of stroke or the type of stroke may differ in men and women. As the age increases, women do not have a stroke in their earlier age, but after 70 years approximately, they can have stroke. Race, blacks are more affected. And if there is a family history of stroke, there is definitely a chance, especially the next of kin, you know, the first generation, there is a chance of having a stroke. We'll move on to the modifiable. The modifiable risk factors are diabetes, obesity, sedentary lifestyle, unhealthy diet, heart diseases, smoking, excessive intake of alcohol, elevated blood pressure and high cholesterol levels. A little bit about everything. I start with hypertension because hypertension is the most cause, the important cause of stroke, be it ischemic stroke or hemorrhagic stroke. Half of the patients, 50% of patients who have stroke will come with an hypertension. Now, we know what is hypertension, what is the upper limit, lower limit, everything. So normally we take it with the age, 130 by 80, you know. So we have to be very controlled. We have to be very cautious about taking care of our blood pressure. Because what happens in stroke is blood pressure. When there's a high blood pressure, it can damage the endothelium and it can, as I said, the intima, it can be damaged, and because of the high pressure, and it can cause narrowing of the vessels. And that way it damages and causes ischemic stroke. Diabetes is a silent killer again, and that can also cause stroke because of many modes. Obesity. What is obesity? We generally look at the hip to waist ratio, and they say the waist circumference for a male is, if it is more than 102 centimeters, and for a female, if the waist circumference is more than 88 centimeters, we call it as obesity, and that is a risk for having a stroke. Sedentary lifestyle, inactivity, physical inactivity, no work, definitely becomes a risk factor for stroke. And so WHO recommends 30 minutes of brisk exercises. It can be cycling, it can be walking, it can be doing some kind of work so that we will, you know, burn our calories. Unhealthy diet. These days, modern days, we are very fond of fast food items, and we know what are the unhealthy diet. Unhealthy diet actually leads to a decrease in HDL and an increase in LDL. So when that happens, that is going to be very, very bad for the blood vessels, because atherosclerosis can happen, fatty deposits will be there, and unhealthy diet should be prevented. And unhealthy diet also leads to high homocysteine values. Now, homocysteine is a component, is an amino acid which is actually a neurotoxin. It's a direct neurotoxin which can lead to polycythemia, increased viscosity, and then leading to atherosclerosis. So we have to eat healthy diet like vegetables, fruits, and avoid fatty food items, so that the risk factor of the stroke will be prevented. Heart diseases like any heart diseases, congestive cardiac failure or atrial fibrillation, atrial flutter, endocarditis, all these are risk factors for stroke. Any patient who is admitted with a cardiac problem, we must look in for this, because eventually a patient can have a stroke. Smoking, all of us know, is bad. So people ask how many cigarettes can I smoke or something like that. I think it's better to quit smoking, because you all know smoking nicotine causes stenosis of the blood vessels, and it also causes polycythemia, and so it's very, very bad for the vessels. Excessive intake of alcohol. When I was reading about this, they say to a mild consumption of alcohol, that is about 30 ml per day is good. But this 30 ml per day can lead to an alcohol abuse or an addiction, and then it becomes bad. So it is better to avoid consumption of alcohol. High cholesterol levels is also very. So these are the modifiable risk factors that we have. Now when we talk about, again, about the risk factors, you have under the ischemic stroke, you have hypertension as the first leading cause of stroke, smoking, waist to hip ratio, diet, physical inactivity, hyperlipidemia, diabetes, alcohol consumption, cardiac causes, and this is apolipoprotein B to A1. We don't have to worry too much about it, but it is all, as I said, it is B protein, a protein which is very, very bad. So we have to only eat, all that we have to remember about apolipoprotein is that we have to eat healthy diet, that is all. Coming on to the hemorrhagic stroke, again you see hypertension is the first leading cause of hemorrhagic stroke, and smoking the same as obesity, alcohol consumption and diet. So if we are careful about these risk factors, we are very sure we can prevent stroke. Now other than these, there are many other risk factors which I have not listed here, like snoring. These days we also have breathing difficulty or snoring habit people, and that is going to that is also another cause of stroke. Stress, which is not listed here. Sometimes patient people say I am very good at, I am very active with exercises, my diet I am uncontrolled, my hypertension is controlled, diabetes is controlled, all is controlled, but still the patients have stroke. Why? Because of stress. Stress can be another reason. In women, if they are on oral contraceptives or if they are postmenopausal, all these can lead to a venous stroke, which we will not be talking much about it, but they can also have stroke. So all these risk factors have to be taken into account whenever we talk about stroke. When I conclude it, I'll give you some studies which have done and what is the current scenario in India about these risk factors. The next thing that we are going to see is, now many people are very eager to know, do I have stroke? How do I know that I have stroke? And there are some stroke risk cards that are available in the medical field. And the first one is this, which is created by the National Stroke Association, which is called a stroke risk scorecard. And you see the risk factors here: blood pressure, atrial fibrillation, smoking, cholesterol, diabetes, exercise, diet, stroke in family. And the red says the high risk stroke. Caution, that the yellow thing is just a caution, and the green is the low risk. So ideally we should be in the green column. If you have about 3 stroke risk factors in the high risk, then you have a very high risk. Say for example, if there is overweight, if there is stroke in family, if there is diabetes, or if they are a smoker, you know, all this, more than 3, you have high risk. And if you have 4 to 6 in the yellow column, you have a moderate risk. You have to be very cautious. If you have everything in low risk, you are free of stroke. You know, you will not develop. Of course, as I said, the stress is another common factor that we have to take into account. This is another risk score calculator, which is called as Framingham. Here, you can see the aspects, whether you are a male or a female, the age in years, total cholesterol level, the high density protein, and you are a diabetic, are you a smoker,
and what is your systolic BP? Are you on antihypertensive any medication? So if you calculate this, this will give you what is the risk of stroke you have. This is the recent one which is called as CHADS2 score. This has, you can, as you can see here, the congestive heart failure bar, LV dysfunction, hypertension, age more than 75 years, diabetes, stroke or transient ischemic attack, vascular disease, age, sex group if you are a female, and the maximum points is about 9. So you actually have to give the score in like that, and depend, the higher the score, the more risk you have. So this is called as CHADS2 score. So we saw about risk factors, but there are also definitive causes of stroke, which is a cardiac source, where I said valve disease, arrhythmias, dilated cardiomyopathy, myocardial infarction, paradoxical emboli, aorta, all these are cardiac sources, and you can have a large vessel disorders like atherosclerosis, or a small vessel occlusive disorder which is hypertension induced disease, peripheral vascular disease, systemic lupus erythematosus, or hematologic disorders like polycythemia, there is a severe leukocytosis, thrombocytosis, antithrombin deficiency, protein C cell deficiency, protein S deficiency, factor 5 deficiency, and the hypercoagulable state where patients have dehydration. They go into dehydration and because of that they develop an hypercoagulopathy. Okay, so these are the causes of stroke. Okay, now we move on to the classification of strokes. The general classification is ischemic and hemorrhagic stroke. 85% of the stroke is an ischemic stroke and only about 13-15% is hemorrhagic stroke. Which is it a good news to us? No, both strokes are bad. Only thing, ischemic stroke, yes, there is treatment. Hemorrhagic stroke, it's only supportive care, and actually right now the treatment is not really available. And coming down to ischemic stroke, it is further divided into 5 subgroups. I'll start with the large artery thrombosis, that is atherosclerotic disease, which accounts for about 20%. What do we mean by large artery thrombosis? It includes middle cerebral artery, anterior cerebral artery occlusions. That is called as large artery. Lacunar stroke is small penetrating artery thrombosis. Now what is meant by lacunar? Lacunar is a small vessels thing. Small vessels, but its vessels are only small, and these are unique vessels which supply the brain parts which is underneath the brain. It is not on the cortex, but you will have to see it underneath. Like, and it supplies areas like internal capsule, thalamus, basal ganglia, all these areas. Now these areas are very, very important for many of the activities of our daily living activities. So though it is called as lacunar stroke, it is not a very simple thing, and it accounts for 25% of stroke. And then we come to the cardiogenic emboli, which is about 20%. Like I mentioned, infective endocarditis or valve disorders, when the left ventricle pumps out unwanted things into the circulation, into the brain circulation, that can become a cardiogenic emboli. Cryptogenic is about 30%. Now what is cryptogenic? It's, we do not know the cause. There is no, you cannot rule out a cause, you cannot say this is what is causing the stroke. That is cryptogenic, and that accounts for. Others are, as I said, PVD, any other disease that is there which can contribute to an ischemic stroke. Hemorrhagic stroke, there are only 2 divisions, which is subarachnoid hemorrhage and then intracerebral hemorrhage. What we mean by intracerebral hemorrhage is when there is a parenchymal bleeding. There is just blood leak into the brain parenchyma and you can see it, and that is what is. Subarachnoid hemorrhage usually happens when there is an aneurysm and it bleeds, and then the subarachnoid space is filled with hemorrhage. So these are the 2 divisions in hemorrhagic stroke. This is another classification. I'm sorry for the small letters, but I hope that you'll be able to see it. Generally, when you have stroke, you have a vascular system. So when you say vascular system, it can be an arterial in origin or venous in origin. Mostly stroke is called as arterial strokes, and venous, I'll come to it later. So in the arterial, when you come the next step of pathophysiology, it is infarct and hemorrhage, which is infarct is ischemic stroke is 85% and hemorrhagic stroke is 15%. Then you have the site of lesion, where you can have in the anterior circulation place, or you have a posterior circulation, which is also about 65% to 20 to 30%. Mostly it is anterior circulation stroke. And further dividing anterior circulation, you have different kinds of tags and packs, and we won't go into the detail. That is called as a clinical classification, where you have to look at the symptoms of the patient and then try to treat. Then the common pathophysiology in all these things is it can be an embolism, it can be a thrombus, it can be thrombus in situ, or it can be, you know, any cardioembolic, it can be anything. Now coming to lastly to the venous stroke, mostly it is called as cerebral venous infarcts, and patients they present in a different manner, and the treatment is also kind of a little different. So this here in this series we will only stick on to the ischemic strokes, the arterial strokes, and not the venous strokes. But going on to the symptoms and signs, these are the symptoms that you will come across when you have a patient with stroke. Hemiparesis, one-sided weakness of the body. Monoparesis, which is one limb weakness. Hemisensory deficits, monoocular or binoocular visual loss, visual field deficits, diplopia, dysarthria, facial drop, ataxia, vertigo, aphasia, sudden decrease in level of consciousness. When you initially started, when the stroke used to be defined as an episode of no blood loss or no blood to the brain, which is non-convulsive. But the definition is slightly changed now, because a full-blown stroke can still have convulsions, and patients can also have seizures at a later time. That's why I have not included seizures here. So these are the symptoms and signs. If you look at the signs and symptoms for a stroke, every vessel, there will be different presentation. Every area of the brain, there will be a different presentation. If there is frontal lobe which is not getting the blood supply, that will have a different presentation. If it's middle cerebral artery which is having an ischemia, and middle cerebral artery supplies to the area where the patient is able to move, the motor activities, they will present with a motor deficit. So I'm not telling you every part of the brain, which, because it's all different. But there's one simple thing that we can understand. That is, how do you identify? Now, when a patient comes to the hospital, we normally do a thorough physical examination and find out what are the symptoms that the patient presents, and then only we go into a differential diagnosis, and then we diagnose and then start treatment. But in stroke, that can't happen. Why? Because that is why I've inserted the slide here. Because the first 6 hours following a stroke is very, very important. A patient can be saved with immediate medical attention. So you can't be sitting and doing a thorough physical examination and all. And if you see here in this picture, there are 4 brain images, which says the green is the penumbra area, and the red is the core infarct area. In the first 10 minutes, you have a lot of penumbra area with a little of core area. In the 1 hour, you see penumbra decreases and the core infarct becomes bigger. And the 3rd hour, the 6th hour, you see the infarct area is expanded, all the penumbra area is eaten up. So this is what happens in the first 6 hours. So if you take less than hour, your main aim is to treat the penumbra area, because the core infarct area is already dead. You can't do anything about it. And your aim of treatment will be to treat the penumbra area. So we can't be sitting and wasting time. So the best way to identify stroke is use this mnemonic, FAST. Okay. Initially it was only FAST, because we were only concentrating on the anterior circulation stroke. Later on, there were people who were coming with posterior circulation, so they included the B into it. So it becomes an acronym, BFAST in stroke. What does that stand for? B stands for balance. When there is a loss of balance, okay, there is headache, the dizziness, or eyes, and there is a blurred vision. Face, one side of the face is drooping. And you ask them to say E or smile, you find that there is drooping is there. Arms, you know, you ask them to lift their arms, there is drifting of arms down. They will not be able to hold on for even for a few seconds. Speech difficulty will be there. So B stands for balance, E stands for eyes, face, arms, speech. Time is not a symptom, but that is just to tell us that you have to rush into the hospital to save the patient. Now, we have to definitely remember this. Even if you do not remember anything, sometimes what happens, even healthcare workers or normal citizens, when there is, you feel dizzy, you may think, I did not eat today, so that is why I am feeling dizzy. Or you have a blurred vision, say, maybe my hypertension, which I always do. So, when there is something like that, it is, if we are very sure about the symptom, this is why it has happened, it is okay. But if you have something like balance, eyes, face is affected, it is always better to reach the hospital and get it ruled out. If it is not going to be stroke, happy for us. But if it is stroke or if it's a TIA, it is better for us to furthermore intervene to it and then prevent further damage. This is called as Rosia scale, which is the expansion of the scale is recognition of stroke in the emergency department, okay, emergency room. So that's why it's called as Rosia scale. So a patient comes with you identify someone in the place, in your location, that they have fast positive, then you bring them here, you can do a quick assessment here and say what was the symptom, what is the GCS, whether the patient is conscious, unconscious, is there any seizure activity. This will really tell you if it's a stroke or not. So you don't have to really waste any time to do a major physical examination, waste of time. And quickly, if you know stroke, if you know it's a stroke, you can proceed on with the diagnosis. So this is called as a Rosia scale. Now, when patients come with TIA, sometimes there are very educated patients who are very aware of stroke. They will say, when I got up this morning, I had some symptoms like this, but now I am very, very clear. I have nothing and I just want to rule out. That's a very good thing to do, because TIA, in the symptoms appear and disappear. Within 1 hour, they all disappear. As it came, it disappears. Sometimes it can last for 24 hours and then disappear. There's something called as wake-up stroke. That is, you do not know. Patient goes to sleep whatever time and they are normal when they go to sleep. But when they get up, whatever time, they have symptoms of stroke. That is called wake stroke. Now, that is very difficult to identify whether this is stroke or not stroke and all that. But still, when they come to the hospital, a thorough examination has to be done, a CT has to be taken, and then they will decide what to do for those kind of patients. So this is called a Rosia scale. Now, this is the NIHSS. There is no title over there. This is called as NIHSS. Now, this is a scale that is being used not to identify stroke, but this is to tell what is the severity of the stroke. When you do all these 9 things with the scale, there are some more items there, and the total score will be 42. Now, that was the original scale, which has a score of 42. Now, they reduced it to 15. Some says 20, some Oxford says 15. So, like that, different NIHs are there. When we do this, it will tell you what is the severity of stroke, whether can you treat or not, okay. And so if the NIHS score is 0, which means there is no stroke, if it is 0 to 4, if it's a minor stroke, then 5 to 15 moderate stroke, 16 to 20 moderate to severe stroke, and 21 to 42 severe stroke. So this will tell you, and that will also tell you what is the impacted brain density. It's a very important tool that we have to use when a patient comes with stroke to our. With this, in this context, I also want to tell you, when I talking about the blood supply, the brain has to get about 60 ml of blood. To have more optimal function of the brain, there must be 60 ml of blood to 100 grams of brain, and then only it will be adequate. So blood supply is a very, very important thing that we have to remember in when we talk about stroke or any brain damage. And that is the reason, you know, when there is a patients coming with stroke, it is this, you should not delay time at all. Just remember the BFAST, and remember, if you think this is like a stroke, it is important that we shift the patient immediately to the hospital for further management. And so I want to tell this also as I go to conclude, because it may look very discontinued talk, because I am talking only few things, that is how we are doing it. But at the end of the session, you will be able to appreciate what are the management things or what are the nursing assessment that we do. Now this door to needle time tells you that any patient who has a stroke, within 60 minutes if they come to the hospital, we can treat them. Especially ischemic stroke, whichever vessel is, large vessel is affected, they can be given drug that is available within 16 minutes only. If they come, we can even reduce the disability or morbidity. We have had patients who come like this within 60 minutes if they receive the drug, you know. Even sometimes it's 75 minutes. If they receive the drug, it's like a magical transformation. Patients recover all their symptoms that they have lost, and they have gone back by walk. So it is very important that we remember this door to needle time. This again we will be discussing in further lectures also. Just remember. So to conclude today's session, what I want to tell you is the risk factors, okay, is very important. Remember three things in the risk factors, okay: more hypertension, reduce obesity, healthy lifestyle and activity. If you remember these things, okay, we will definitely cut down on the other things. And of course, age is not in our hand. We keep aging, but just make sure that we go for normal checkups and the annual checkups, things like that, so that we are also clear. So that is about today's lecture. Thank you. I am happy to answer your questions if there are any questions. Because in this interruption, I would have missed out something. If you want to include something, I'll be happy to listen to you also. There is a question here whether depression patients develop stroke. To my knowledge, stroke patients develop depression, because that is one of the complications. Depression patients developing stroke depends on their comorbidities, depends on the risk factors. They will develop. There is a chance of developing a stroke. Because if a depressive patient is on, it's an hypertensive, or he has diabetes, or he has any other comorbidities like cardiac illnesses, then definitely there is a risk that he'll develop stroke. I hope that answers your question. Can happen to anyone with any disease condition. If the risk factors are there, stroke, because stroke is just the ischemia, the blood vessel narrowing. If there is atherosclerosis, anybody having encephalitis and they have the risk factors of stroke, they will have stroke. So anyone will have stroke. If you have the risk factors. As I said, you know, there are treatments. Treatment is available for stroke, but if they come very late, if the NIHS score is more than 21, you know, if it is between 21 to 42 and they come at that time, even treatment cannot really help. Because they will already have pure motor deficits or sensory deficits. Sometimes they have motor and sensory deficits, and the treatment will not be very useful for them. And then the morbidity becomes, disability is very high in them. And what will be the lifespan for an individual after a stroke? we've had patients who with the stroke, they had for at least about 5 years to 6 years, maximum that I know is a person with after 6 years stroke, but they do not die because of stroke, but they die because of the complications that develop after stroke. There are many, many complications. The most important complication is urinary tract infection or pneumonia. So they generally, that will become a problem. But I really cannot tell you what will be the lifespan. If the complications are prevented, they can actually live for a longer time. The second question here is, what are the chances of having stroke in high cholesterol level? There are high chances. I can't tell you the percentage. Maybe in the next series, I will tell you what is the chances of, I can look up some studies and then tell you what are the chances in percentage. But the chances are very high if there's a high cholesterol level, because that is going to lead to atherosclerosis, and it is a very not a very good sign. What is the recovery period of a stroke? Is that a person recover from stroke? We can't really say what is the recovery period, is not say, but if they come within the 3 hours, I was telling about the door to needle time. If they come from the time of occurrence of stroke, within 3 hours, if they come to the hospital, a tertiary setup where the drug can be given immediately, there are high chances of them becoming all right, because the condition will be just reverted if they receive the drug that I told you, Actilize. And there the recovery is very good. But again, if they come with a high NIHS score, then the recovery is going to be very bad, and then the disability will be very high also. Who will recover, who will not recover, we won't be able to say, because you know, even after they sometimes receive treatment, posterior circulation stroke, thalamic stroke, all these are very difficult to predict and say whether they will become alright. We've had patient who came with a huge bacillar stroke. She was given treatment, and that person is very active and alright, very healthy. So we have such cases that we can present. So that's how it is. I hope that it can be prevented. How can we prevent it? We are having patient information. We do time and we keep doing this awareness study, and then we keep teaching, educating the patients, general public about the risk factors and how they can prevent stroke. And that itself is a major step, and you know, that will help. Stroke patients do have spasticity, especially when they have hemiparesis, they have shoulder spasticity. That needs treatment, that needs exercise, and there are other rehabilitative devices that are available to reduce spasticity. That will be done by the PMR department. But there are devices to reduce spasticity. Does it run in the family? Yes. As I said, heredity is one of the non-modifiable risk factor. If it is in the family, the first generation may have. There are a lot of studies which have proved that. So, but the good news is, we can, you know, reduce all the modifiable risk factors so that we keep healthy and prevent stroke. This age is a major risk factor after 55 years. But these days we have seen young stroke in India. We have seen many young stroke between 40 to 50 years. Also, we receive patients with young stroke. Age is a major risk, especially men who are between 40 to 50. If they are alcoholic, if they are smokers, that is a very high risk factor. Age combined with hypertension, diabetes, or smoking or alcohol is very bad. It is a major risk factor. Major symptoms of stroke are, again, it depends on which vessel is affected, which part of the brain is affected. But things that will be major symptoms when you say hemiparesis. If it's a middle cerebral artery, usually you have hemiparesis. And the other next symptom that is major is aphasia. Aphasic is they cannot speak, sometimes they cannot understand, or sometimes they cannot speak, which is motor aphasia. Sometimes you can have global aphasia. So aphasia is the next major symptom. So hemiparesis, aphasia, and are the two major symptoms that you can have. Rest of it, like blurred vision or visual deficits, all these are symptoms that will appear, but not major like hemiparesis and aphasic. Thank you very much for your patient listening. I don't know if I was able to cover everything within this 1 hour, but definitely if you can bring your questions in the next session, we will be very happy to answer you and share the knowledge with you.